Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, welcome back to Game 2 in this best-of-three showdown between Vici Gaming and Evil Geniuses. For those of you who are watching the Beyond the Summit 2 stream, unfortunately the PC that was streaming the game did crash, but we should have OG versus IG Vitality back for you guys in just a few moments. In the meantime, for those just joining us for this series, EG currently trailing 0-1. It was a pretty close game to open things up through the mid-game, but a series of very unfortunate deaths for Sumail without buyback resulted in EG getting run over, losing their entire base. I'm LD. I'm joined here by Gods for game number two.
Game two, time for EG to step up. I mean, it's the Secret who first with their new roster didn't quite live up to expectations. Now EG, you know, let's see if they can perhaps surprise some people. But so far, it's been like the most stable teams. I mean, let's say stable. Newbie's got a new roster. Vici Gaming's brought in Ghost. But their teams have been actually playing official matches, they've been playing qualifiers, they've had a bit more actual practice leading up outside of scrims, and so far that's paid off for them.
So, as far as adjustments go this game, it is the Kunkaban. This is a hero that rose to prominence during TI, has been getting picked a lot since then, getting the respect ban here. So, 10 seconds remaining. What are we expecting in this game, Gods? Last game was a first overall pick, Keeper of the Light.
I'm expecting something completely different. Like, I mean, Sand King for starters, that's something completely different. But I think if you're EG, you've obviously only been playing scrims, and scrims you're really like scrims is a new team. It's not just you've been playing scrims; it's that you've got a completely new roster. You probably tried all different play styles. You probably tried like more push heavy. You've tried like 10 seconds ones where you're, that game was like more split push, playing around the Sumail Tinker. I'm sure they've got like 5 to 10 different styles and drafts that they want to just try out, and this is just let's go to Plan B. That's all this game is to me.
Sand King first overall. Yeah, generally, when we've seen the SK, it has been in the offlane with help. I think that's probably the most common way that the hero's been run. Situationally, we'll see him in like that 1v1 mid if it's a really easy melee matchup. But because they banned Kunkka Gods, that means that the Yang Batrider slips right through, and the Oracle's already been taken by VG, so probably the most popular way to counter the lasso nowadays is already on Vici's in their capable hands, I should say.
Yeah. Ban it game one, you decide something else more banworthy game two, and they'll sure as hell take it. So Oracle's been one of the standout heroes throughout today. You go back to the newbie series and constantly the false promises to get clutch saves off. It was the Fortune's End to purge stuff. I mean, all those spells just so ridiculously good in different situations. So definitely a hero that may even start getting some first stage bans, but it's so open as far as what you can play and what you can do that it's hard to say, oh, you got to first ban this hero, then something else will slip through. That's how the bat gets through this game.
So what do you pick to deal with it? They go for Omni Knight first phase here. I don't think he's really the bat counter per se.
Yeah.
But is this like a... Do you think this is an Omni Knight with a particular like purpose already? Or is it more they just like Omni Knight and they're going to build around him moving forward?
I think there's a purpose. I don't know what the purpose is, LD, but 5 seconds remaining. There should be a purpose.
I know there will be a purpose, or at least there's some. Like, Sand King Omni versus Oracle Bad. I feel like Sand King Omni is, great against Oracle
Bad. This is
Bad.
More me saying as someone who, I mean, we're watching EG play their first games. I have no idea what they're doing when they pick this, but I don't know what the purpose is, but we'll find out probably as the next couple of picks come out. It's not really picked immediately to counter the Bad or the Oracle, particularly. It's just, again, to enable Sumail or a TZ's hero, whatever we're going to be seeing them on. It's something that can perhaps synergize and combo well with Omni Knight.
So the Lion will be removed here, and we'll have to see what the intent of that ban is. Obviously great against illusion-based heroes. Perhaps they want to run someone who's a little more mobile, like a Storm Spirit, 5 seconds perchance. We'll wait and see what the plan is.
Lion not seemingly the strongest support now, but they probably look at the pool and they're like, there's not many safe lane supports left. Let's perhaps target some bans on some that can cause problems at least.
Someone who is available, by the way, is Drow. First phase banned series, or snagged right up if she wasn't. But this time around, instead, EG removed the Huskar. 10 seconds. The Drow remains available.
What do they want to go? Turn this whole band out.
And this feels like a Terrorblade pick right now with the TB Lion bands, but
for Vici, yeah. And that's where the Lion as well as the Timber here. For sure, TB works very well. Something EG can easily ban out, but Sand King's decent matchup. TB, not a hero that likes to build BKB. Laning stage, you can put a lot of pressure on him with a dual lane, and that's perhaps what they're thinking with Sand King Omni Knight. But if you're picking Omni Knight just to have this strong lane with Sand King, Dazzle's perhaps the stronger option. That's what Na'Vi were doing with his Sand King Dazzle dual lane in the off lane. So I think it's more, I mean, you could dual lane it, and then you've also got the strong mid game with Repel. So that's where it's a slightly weaker lane, but you've got a better mid game with Dazzle.
Yeah, I was also thinking maybe Vici's trying to like trick EG into thinking they still want the Terror Blade, and then they're just going to snap pick a Drow instead, but EG will just go ahead and ban out the Drow. So something will be something fresh here for Vici. What are some other carries this team likes to run? And he's very well known for his Juggernaut, his Sven. We've seen a little Morphling, not super common. I'm not as familiar with Ghost or what he likes to play mid. Do you know, does anything in particular jump out? Have you had a chance to watch him much yet?
No, not at all.
Let me see. Did Connell Guy do some good research? Well, his nickname is Ugly Ghost. He's 8.7k MMR. Oh, there is the end, Juggernaut. So. good
sure
against Sand King
Omni. And stuff, you know, like every high MMR player is like, I think it was 8.7k MMR when I saw his, covered over his profile. So, I'm sure the guy's more than capable of playing a lot of different mid heroes to get up there.
Yeah, I like the Jug here. Great against that Burrow and the Repel combo. Can also deal with the Caustic pretty well. Helps to sustain your push, can work on Roshan relatively early. And he's not a hero that needs a whole lot of help, so it frees up the supports to stack for the Batrider. That still leaves the overall game plan pretty flexible here.
Yeah, I mean, looking at Ghost, his most played heroes on Dota buff is Queen of Pain, Invoker,
Queen of
Storm.
Pain.
That's actually his most played hero of all time.
I imagine most of that in the more distant past.
Yeah, Jug is one of his high. He's actually played a lot of Jug mid. It's one of his highest win rates. I mean, again, this is pub games that we're looking at. But
I guess it depends.
Troll Warlord?
I would like a troll.
Troll
pick. Not sure about this game, but
based on some of his heroes, sounds like he used a lot of the flavor of the month heroes at the time. The troll's there, the earth spirit is there. So,
EG, we'll grab the Beastmaster. Is it I mean, now you got to ask, like, what are EG's lanes? I was thinking, yeah, Sand King Omni Knight dual lane, off lane. Then it's like, oh, does Beastmaster jungle and they still do that? Do they put one of these heroes mid and then the other one in the off lane between the Beastmaster and Sand King? Who's playing what? Who's going where?
I want to say one needs to be mid because if you want to jungle the Beastmaster with Omni support, you have really weak lanes. You've got a lot of melee heroes. That to me is a problem. I think more likely we see something like Sand King mid, Beastmaster. EG's jungle / offlane, you know, but I don't like the idea of having Beastmaster jungling while Omni Knight plays the five position support.
It does
just seems
sound
too
super
weak.
Greedy.
Yeah,
but you never know. So Rubick, how good of a Rubick game? Obviously, this is FY on the Rubick.
Every game is a Rubick game when you're FY, I guess. Sand King Stun is really good. Omni Knight has a lot of purifications. Great, I mean, all of Omni Knight spells you're happy to steal. I don't even know which one you want the most. Perhaps the Repel? I mean, Guardian Angel sounds great, but in a lot of situations, Repel and Heal can be better, so all his spells are amazing.
Well, I do like this Razor pick. That's that hero's super annoying for Batrider. Jug struggles against him quite a bit. And he's independent. He doesn't need help.
Still wondering what they're doing with the lanes. It perhaps could be a safe lane solo hero like we saw last game. They give Arteezy a 1v1 matchup. And that just means their two supports can help out the other lane, stack, jungle, farm, be just a bit more independent.
Well, we'll have to see who's playing what. I mean, Arteezy is known for his Razor, but Sumail has been playing mid. Don't really know that EG would run like a safe lane Razor, per se, so... It's hard to predict EG's lanes. Vici seem a lot more straightforward, though, gods. Like, Batrider off lane... Jug, maybe mid, maybe safe lane, and then the supports just roam in between those two.
Yeah, I'm still confused what EG are doing. I don't even...
Vici's like, we're just gonna ban someone that doesn't need help and can secure the laning stage, because your lineup already looks quite a bit greedy.
Yeah, I think if you're Vici, just focus on what you need to complete your draft. Maybe, like you say, ban an annoying hero, that could perhaps screw up your plan, but... Don't worry too much about what weird stuff EG is doing right now with their lanes and heroes.
So it is a 1-0 advantage, guys, for Vici Gaming. This is the former Vici Gaming Reborn lineup. They have been promoted to Vici Gaming Original, Vici Gaming Classic, after their performance over the past 6 months or so.
And wouldn't you want to be Vici Gaming, the Jeremy Lin team, Vici Gaming J? Like that's like the cool team to be on, right?
Is it?
That's all. Jeremy Lin endorsed one of the Vici Gaming teams. I don't know.
What does that mean? Did he actually invest in the team, or like he gave them all high fives? Like he sent them signed photos of himself?
I think it's a little publicity thing where it's like you, I think it's the latter. He gave them all high fives, and then now they can his name to be like, this is the Jeremy Lin esports team. But I don't think, I mean, I don't know. This is just speculation, but I don't think he's actually that involved with the team. Unlike some of the like some of the players in the America who actually like invested remaining and have their own organizations. This is, I think, a bit different.
Well, EG, they're not thinking about Jeremy Lin right now. They're thinking about how to force a game three. They ban out the Naga, and they will proceed into their final pick. Three melee heroes already. They're very level dependent. They don't really need that much farm gods, but they need a lot of levels already, this lineup. And it's a Slark, so it's a support. It is a Jungle Beastmaster support Omni Knight? What is this draft?
Probably. Most likely, that sounds That sounds manageable. You could do the Sand King support. That's also feasible, but I mean, the nice thing is for the safe lane, you've got a Razor who's a Rain Seer, so having a Sand King there roaming around could be kind of annoying to deal with, but not entirely sure what they're doing. This is very open. The Slark Omni Knight lane, at least you've got to pounce in to set up for the heal bomb, so that's not the weakest of lanes.
And it could be against a Batrider if it's an offlane bat, which is normally what you would assume with VG having Yang, who's has an immaculate bat, but do you think there's like a chance they just run a mid bat for Ghost, put something else off lane, maybe a Void?
Very possible. They don't want to do the mid jug anymore with the Razor picked up, so.
Because it seems to me like they want that like Slark first bat matchup, and I feel like Vici have to recognize that. It's not like a big special tactic or anything.
I think bat matches up pretty poorly against Razor as well, so they may be more inclined to pick like a standard mid hero that can sit back, last hit.
Okay.
Puck. The Quap, maybe, you know? His most played hero.
Guarantee mage.
Okay, so it is the mid jug for Ghost.
Yeah, mid jug and safe lane anti mage. So he's just going to Blade Fury down creep waves and try shrug off the damage seal, I guess.
And he will be laning against a Sumail Razor, so not the most fun matchup generally for jug.
It's tough. Once you get a few levels, you can Blade Fury to farm, but even when you're Blade Furying, Sumail can still time the denies, so.
Do you like this anti-mage pick?
Yeah, it's a good anti-mage game. There's no, Slark doesn't match up great against the hero. The one hero they had that's quite good is the Beastmaster against anti-mage with the roll plus Necrobooks to lock him down. You have got to follow up some of the Sand King, but physical damage-wise, EG take quite a bit of items on Slark and or Razor to actually deal with an anti-mage, and their catch is limited mostly to the Beastmaster, so it's pretty good for him to be split pushing around and being annoying.
Guys, of course, a reminder here for those who want to check out the other match, OG versus IG Vitality, currently underway on Beyond the Summit 2. New OG roster getting their sea legs under them here in MDL action. EG looking to get theirs under them. As FY will scout out Zai. Again with the smoke. They're scouting out these EG wards. This is going to be two games in a row they get the D ward gods.
Yeah, they're going to. I mean, that's a big takeaway if you're EG. You go back and watch these replays and you realize they probably didn't even see the game on replay. You don't have much time between games. And to see that the smoke TP scouts out their ward placement.
Well, I think he saw it.
No, the sentries it's are.
On FY.
They
yeah.
don't have sentries? Okay.
I think he's waiting to see if anyone else is in the neighborhood. There's the D ward. FY, like, fighting Ghost for the wards. Pump fake.
That's a bounty room, basically, for your mid player to get that ward money. So, it's the faster bottle, you know. So, definitely worth giving it to Ghost.
Yeah, and in a disadvantaged matchup, it's one where you give him that, you give him a bounty rune, maybe you even deny the Razor, and could be in great shape.
Maybe even rush his boots just so you get out of the static link. But like in the staff of Ichi Gaming once again, and they should have pretty stable lane. So it will be a support tank. We're kind of questioning where are these drafts going to be. Crit is on the support Omni Knight, which means Universe playing the offlane slash Iron Talon jungling Beastmaster, a core Beastmaster.
What do you think about support Sand King nowadays? We used to see that very passive, you know, stack the jungle, get your level 3, just level up Sandstorm and go clear the jungle at that point. He has started Windlace here. Are you expecting that just very passive style of Sand King? Is there a better way to play him, given the hero matchup, given the state of the game nowadays?
He wants to impose himself on his lane. The problem is mid-jug is not a hero you can gank because of the Blade Fury. The top lane's an anti-mage. The only real gankable lane is this bottom lane where the Batrider is. So he's very limited as far as lanes he can actually threaten. Right now he's just going to hover around this bottom lane, but more likely he's just going to have to stack full and play the farm game because there's no lane where he can actually really pose a big threat.
So you see anti-mage getting complete free farm. Of course the trade is a very fast jungle performance from Universe, undoubtedly. Crit looking to deal with FY, who wanted to be a nuisance in the woods. But that will be prevented. Iron Talon already picked up. So free farm AM, AFK jungle Beastmaster, Zai trying to do the zoning thing bottom. Razor with a pretty good matchup against the Jug. Both teams trying to give a bit of help to that mid lane early. Do you prefer either team's lanes, Gods?
Slightly prefer what Vici, as far as what Vici Gaming is getting out of lanes, just because it's a free farming anti-mage. He's got an empty lane. I guess Beastmaster with the jungle is a similar story. Yang at bottom getting a little pressured quite a lot, but they can't even get this kill with three heroes, and Yang is already level 2.5.
And that frees up FY, who is going to start to be pesky here in the jungle.
He was trying to do that earlier when Crit found him, but this is the beauty of this boots first, is even if you get found, they can't kill you, I want to say. Maybe with some sick body blocks here, but FY with boots.
No degen, no mana for follow burrow, so they do have to let him go.
This is one support keeping two supports busy, so the trade-off there is easily worth it. Universe even lost a bit of his like farm and XP from having the Rubick there as well, so all in all, very annoying stuff coming out from FY.
And they are definitely winning here when it comes to CS. End is already doubling up the cores of EG. And the Batrider bottom has worked out pretty well. He's forced three heroes to the lane. He slowed down Arteezy's farm, who's significantly behind the enemy anti-mage. The one lane they're slightly winning is mid, but Ghost is still CSing here, God. So things are looking really good for Vici Gaming thus far. They are already up 750 gold, about 500 experience against a Jungle Beastmaster. Used to be whenever you'd see the Jungle Beastmaster, it was like the old Enigma, where it's like, all right, they're going to be up like 1,000 plus experience in a couple of minutes, but not the case so far.
They recognize the weak lanes, they're going to be going for the kill on the mid-raiser here. They smoke up. Rubick, after suiciding TP's top, smokes up, and the lift with Blade Fury should be enough for a kill here.
And the spin goes through. Sumail's doing a lot of damage, but he gets pulled back towards the Oracle. The Blade Fury gets it done, and Ghost will collect his first blood and walk safely away. So true to form, FY, he's known for his early roaming, even though we see it a bit less nowadays. He is certainly known for not being afraid to smoke gank, and was managed to secure first blood. Sumail got a little early help from the Omni, but left to his own, will now pay.
FY is one of those players who just always finds a way to get involved early. Pressuring the jungle, now he's mid, getting a first blood for his team.
Looking for Yang bottom, though. That would be a big pick off. EG are going to secure it at the same time, though. The trade comes top as Vici Gaming bring down Universe on the Beastmaster, so no good deed going unpunished here. They still manage to find trades around the map. You see Arteezy keeping relatively even with the AM, all things considered. He's no longer being doubled up anyway. But already you can see Vici are going to look to play the economy game later on. They're stacking Ancients. They don't really mind if they give up a kill here or there in the bat. They feel like they can just out-farm EG a bit later on. FY, I think, just killed the Courier.
Is that the boar? There was a boar over in that area. I don't know.
Where did it die?
Oh, sorry, that was Universe. Oh, it was the Radiant Courier that died, not the Dire one. Yeah, I don't know.
I think it was FY who killed it off. And now looking to make a move on Sumail in the mid lane. They lift him up, they get the crit, and that will prompt the Blade Fury. FY letting the zap go. Sumail, he does have the Fairy Fire. And he will make it out, but they cancel that salve. Vici Gaming successfully punishing him and really making this mid lane difficult. Razor down 800 net worth right now to the enemy Juggernaut. And that largely the first blood.
Yeah, That's one of those ganks where it was basically the outcome was basically just as good as getting the kill, because he has to walk all the way back to base, heal up, buy a TP or buy a salve, and then come back to lane. So the outcome is Jug gets some farm, perhaps slightly less, but it's still a very good outcome. Gosh, Zai is playing so close here. The top lane, trying to juke the anti-mage, and it looks like he'll barely do so. A bit of a greedy build from End, where he's got more points in stats, means he won't find that kill.
So it looks like the Courier actually, I think it died top, so maybe AM just blinked and killed it.
Gotcha.
I had to rebind my hotkey because they added the new feature where you can press any button to select a hero. But yeah, Michi Gaming, Ghost now bottling up the regen rune. He is closing in on Omni Slash, and this is the one situation where you can maybe get a kill on a Razor where you normally wouldn't be able to, is when you first get that Omni, but bottom. There's the lift onto Arteezy. He does have his ultimate ready now, but forcing it out would be pretty big. Not even going to be able to do that, though. Very patient play by Artur.
They almost got there before his level 6. If they got there before the level 6, could have been a kill, but instead, we'll see Arteezy go aggressive.
Just see FY stacking, stacking the enemy jungle as well.
Yeah, that's
a little unusual.
Arteezy?
Moving
in.
Aggressive. They have found FY, a deep dive for him, and now the rappel onto Arteezy. He will have a pounce available in about 10 seconds, but Dark Pack ready sooner, and FY will end up going down, just left for the wolves. And it looks like they're going to stack it so that Yang can farm it. So.
Sure.
They still get that economic advantage in terms of CS here, though. It does come at the cost of a hero in this case.
Yeah.
Not often you see a team stacking the enemy jungle for their bat when their tier 1s are still up. But
Yang is farmed. He has got 2.3k net worth, 1300 gold towards his blink dagger. This is fantastic farm for a bat rider to have in the offlane. And that's where this laning set for EG was just, and the draft as a whole was kind of confusing, and you're kind of guessing, like, how are they going to lane this? They don't have any hero to zone the offlaner, and this is what happens when you can't zone the offlaner. Batrider at 7 minutes in is like two-thirds of the way to a blink dagger. Unfortunately, he misses a stack, but even so, this bat is very, very good.
Universe has made his way up towards top. They're now giving the lane to Crit while they leave the Beastmaster in the jungle. Radiant Courier now going to respawn, and it's got a lot of work to do, this little Venno lane, as it will fly out, but the smoke gank descends on the top lane. The rappel is there, but Universe already pulled up into the air. It's enough to keep him alive, that rappel. Weren't able to latch on anyone in time. Nobody really low as far as Monty goes. We will see End working towards his Battle Fury, keeping eyes out for stacks. They've got a decent amount here. It looks like three double stacks overall guts.
Yep. The nice thing about this jump pick is they will have a Diffusal buy to deal with the rappel as well. Smoke towards the mid lane, though. They aren't going to stop any of the stacks. It looks like they'd rather go for the kill on Ghost.
And they do have the Roar, so this will be tough for the Juggernaut. Already Blade Fury committed, but his damage being stolen. Backup coming in the form of that Oracle. Not level 6 just yet, and not enough to save him.
See that Oracle TP? I'm like, if that's level 6 Oracle, like, that could just turn things, well, not turn around the kills, but save his life and waste EG's time.
Yeah, because you get
a nice
just,
kill to get.
You can just Blade Fury and pop that Omni when the False Promise is about to wear off and really frustrate EG. But good rotation there by the Beastmaster of Universe, finally getting active. It keeps the game still within striking distance for EG now. They would just love for this to be a quiet mid game so they can look to get their farm and levels onto these very farm and experience dependent, well, mainly experience dependent supports.
Strange, because like they want quiet and slow pace, but they're reversing an anti-mage, and that's exactly what he wants as well. So we'll see how that those two kind of play into each other. For now, Batrider, his blink dagger timing could be the go sign for VG Gaming.
So it is a Diffusal Blade rush. No drums for Ghost, not even an Aquila. Already he's grabbed the recipe.
Man, he needs to work on stacking this big gap. He's missed it twice in a row. Disappointing, LD. Disappointing.
That's a bit unfortunate.
I'm like the Asian parent who's just like, nope, you got an A minus. Why isn't that an A plus? Because he's played so ridiculously well this game. It's just like as far as his overall farm, but
he would have the blink by now for sure. So
yep.
It's a little thing, but it can make a difference. As then we'll jump forward, looking for Universe. Blink now complete. Still a very good timing. Where does he look to go? That is the question. Radiant. Who are your eyes on right now if you're Batrider? Anyone in particular you're looking to kill?
I'll be looking to pair up with Jug. Oh, okay. Oh, he guesses wrong with the Blade Fury.
I think he was also hoping Zai didn't have a pointed Sandstorm there, but this is a support Sand King. Now, Ghost trying to run away, and Zai is going to end up outplaying him in Security Kill. I'm pretty sure he's just banking on him not skilling Sandstorm there.
Fortunate for him, and a big kill to give away. DDC will TP out of bottom, but it's sloppy from Ghost. I mean, we saw it kind of in the last game where he makes a mistake, but he comes back big. So he is one of those kind of risky all-in players. Lasso at top, though. Yang, he's found Universe with the Anti-Mage to back up this gank. It will be killing these cards.
And the secure it already has a completed Perseverance. Tower, though, bottom. It's going to end up going down now. So EG, they grab an objective. The first overall tower of the game.
Maybe a trade, though. Anti-Mage gets his top tower. That's practically his completed Battle Fury. And with the Siege Creep support, it may just be the tower going down.
Now the drum's up for Sumail to go with his Infused Raindrop, so tanking up as much as possible on the Razor. What is Arteezy going to go for here? 2500, or Shadow Blade right away?
Yeah, I gotta imagine so. It's just your stable, strong item to get. The tank sneak potential, as well as just the fact that I can do decent damage and stats to go with it. But there we go, AM gets his tower, and that's 150 gold short of a Battle Fury now.
And he TP's away! Oh, that hurts for EG. What a time it would have been to kill him. Would have set that Battle Fury back a couple minutes.
It flies out of there. They see just a double stack, and it's like, is it even worth like just taking your time to steal? They may decide it is, but Anti-Mage, really safe play from him. Great map awareness gets out.
And he does so at like the worst possible time for EG, when they're like an inch away from killing him. But still, EG making aggressive maneuvers here as Arteezy debuts the Shadow Blade, going deep into the enemy woods. Can he jump onto FY? Oh, he almost finds the time. He does get the pounce. The heal is there. The kill is secure. And that will also additionally ensure that they get this tier 1 unopposed in the top lane. Nice pick there by Arteezy.
Good first move, the Observer Ward to help provide the vision, but elsewhere on the map, it's Vici Gaming taking a bottom tier 1 tower, so it's almost the same trade we saw just a minute ago, where EG get the bottom tier 1, Vici get the top, AM then rotates bottom and makes the exact same trade. The Rubick kill, not really too big a deal. Rubick's level 6, he's the kind of sacrificial lamb that scouts out the Shadow Blade, so all in all, Vici Gaming still in a great position just to play its good play.
Center's eye rolling in on mid. He does find the quick pick on FY. Two deaths in a row. FY looking rather mortal. Not very godly at this stage. He had a great start. They have been shutting him down the stretch here. As VG Gaming look for a leap in, but who do you lasso here? If you don't lasso the beast, he roars you. You don't lasso someone else, they get healed and repelled by crit. You don't really want to go on Razor. Zai can burrow out. In the end, he says, I'm not going to lasso anyone.
It's the Observer Ward between the towers that set all that up for the initial kill, but gets taken out. So again, it's Rubick dying to create some space for AM. It is his fourth death, so they are starting to add up a bit. But FY on Rubick, you know, he'll make some plays happen regardless of how underfarmed he is or underleveled. He's probably not too concerned about his own ability to impact this game. But the concern probably comes from Arteezy's luck. Starting to add up has been in four kills. We'll continue to just snowball around this map, and that's where you're going to be thinking, we get an early gem. Yang has got a piece towards his, what I believe to be his 4-star, so he could get a 4-star and then consider a very early gem to help deal with the slot. Even the Sand King with his Invis.
So EG just kind of heading out in the mid lane here, and they are going to opt for a smoke. Beastmaster roar at the ready. Universe moving into the river, but Ghost just outside of their range, it looks like. The roar, do they find the Anti-Mage? He blinks out. There was a ward to scout him, but End is wise to their tricks. He will make it out safely. The smoke still covering a couple of EG arrows, but Zai and Universe were revealed, and now a 14-minute defusal blade. So say goodbye to your level 3 repel if this is used properly. Still, though,
I think it's a bit of a trap to go fight into EG just because your team fight is lackluster compared to theirs. You don't have that big team fight ultimate that we've seen them play with last game. There's no Void, no Tidehunter type hero. Your team fight is a Batrider being able to initiate and get a pick off to start things off, but he can't even reliably do that without a 4-star. So Imagine VG Gaming will still be very kind of tentative to fight into like an Omni, Razor, Beastmaster, Sankey. These are all kind of teamfight specialists.
Are you liking EG's overall game plan here, guys? And just like heavy five-man pressure this early?
Yeah, I think it's good they're capitalizing on the fact that VG Gaming aren't fight ready. The AM wants to split push and farm. The Batrider doesn't have a 4-star, and you've got no real good, reliable initiation. And even Juggernaut himself is fairly squishy. If he gets roared, he's going to go down. This Diffusal Rush does leave him somewhat vulnerable.
Arteezy trying to hunt end here. Does force the TP out, and not really sure if there's anyone else behind him. Little TP away, back to safety. Starts farming up neutrals. Already a Yasha complete, though. Even though Slark is a decent farmer, no one is keeping up with this AM on their own. So it's going to have to be a team effort by EG to deal with him down the stretch.
He'll just continue to try find pickoffs on supports where possible, but needs to, like you say, maintain his level of farm as well if he wants to fight the AM later on. Otherwise, we'll get to this point where AM has like Manta, Abyssal, and just blinks on Slark, Abyssals him, burns his mana, blows him up.
EG, still waiting on that Zai blink for their reliable initiation. Is you never stood up for the Necro book. Probably the more standard Beastmaster build. Sometimes we see the Necro one back into a blink, but rarely do we see a blink rush nowadays. Does mean, though, they're lacking reliable initiation. Something VG have been able to play around so far.
In some ways, I feel like it's probably one of the more important item timings for them. The Necro 3, the other one. Oh, Universe has been called there.
Oh, those eyes behind him. The Burrow only catches out End. Yang is just left free to go to work here. They get off an Epicenter. End doesn't have the mana. The Necro Book prevents the blink out. Universe able to help out there. Arteezy, Zai, Sumail securing the kill in the end.
Sumail with the Boots of Travel Rush. Hadn't seen that item pickup yet, but he uses it to great effect to turn it around. They barely managed to burn enough mana off the Anti-Mage to prevent his blink out, but great turnaround. Zai in the right position, Sumail ready to TP in, and that's the pickoff EG been waiting for. That's like the pickoff that will give you about a 3,000-4,000 gold swing just because of the map control and the tower objective taking that follow it up.
Oh, that's like the dream too, because they're so bad at killing AM without a blink on Sand Cane, but if you can bait him in and force him to come to fights, you can kill him and you can take a tower. That is a coup de grace for EG.
Immediately VG Gaming to shove out the other two lanes, but Arteezy's trying to punish this split push. He's rotating in on bottom, and with a TP support, he could try to fight this one. Oh, he's been spotted. He gets pinged out, and his Shadow Blade did wear off, so.
And he knows there's a ward in the area if he's watching his Shadow Dance, so not going to try to move in any further. We'll back down for now, but this is buying time for Zai. Only 900 to go until that blink. And they are getting their levels. Crit, level 4 heal, level 3 repel. Can get the ultimate soon. The Beastmaster is level 2 ultimate. A gem.
Got a gem.
Necro,
yeah.
3 coming. Sand King
Crit bottom
a
gem. I love this. I love this play because you can find all the wards with the Slark. Like, Arteezy was just pinging around where that ward was, and then they send the Hawk over, easy D ward, and this is just pure early mid-game dominance style of play coming from EG. With the map control that this gem provides, not to mention the vision from the Hawks.
So, where do Vici go from here? What do you reckon is next for them? Are they just farming the AM and playing for late game?
They want to farm the AM, but they can't just do that by playing ultra passive. They probably want to go for some smoke plays. Use like smoke pick off to create space is kind of the best idea for them, while End farms away on the anti-mage. For now, it's Slark scouting them out, finding them on the map, and they perhaps need even a gem of their own just to help counter the vision that, I mean, look at EG's vision right now. They've got wards deep by the T2 mid tower in the Dire jungle. The Slark shadow blading scouting stuff are scouting a lot out, so they, I think, just need a gem themselves.
Well, they have a great hero to carry it in the form of the Batrider, and he does have the money for it should he choose to buy it. Already Blink Force picked up, but let's see, we'll see Arteezy just creeping in the mid lane, hoping to find a pickoff. Has the DD rune ready to go. Shadowblade will wear off. AM. Just slicing and dicing a bit in the jungle.
They're just sitting on this mid observer ward right by their T2 tower. This has been such a value ward planted. VG Gaming all hovered around, scattered out.
That's probably like a minute per hero. They've been under that ward's watchful gaze. It's a lot of confidence. EG have to move around elsewhere as Arteezy is going to run down Ghost. He found the Juggernaut. He's looking for a second. The heal bomb comes through. The lasso's there, but it's on a repelled Arteezy. Can they bring him down in time? It does, certainly doesn't look like it. Now onto Yang. The Oracle to keep him alive, but it's all falling apart for Vici now, and just hoping for a good Monovoid opportunity here. Blinking forward, Yang will end up surviving for the time being. The Oracle gets out, but Yang will fall in the end. And that will force Zen to just back away. Oh no, maybe not. He goes back in with the Monovoid. Then he gets roared. Say hello to the Necro Vulcan. Say goodbye to your life, my friend. 4-0. EG showing some flashes of brilliance here. And it all began with Arteezy and a DD rune.
Yeah, Arteezy, it's similar to game one where it's like brilliance from individual players. Arteezy really steps it up there, gets a solo kill on the Jug. Jug gets pounced and immediately tries to blade through away, but Arteezy knows he's got the damage he needs. Even pops the Shadow Dance just for the movement speed to chase down and get the kill on the Jug. And there was nothing. Rubik's just sitting there like, I can't help you. I'm just going to hope he doesn't see me as well, because if he sees me, we're both dead. And turns out he did see the Rubik, and they both go down. EG just making some great individual plays to get themselves back in this game. And then they turn those individual plays into towers, objectives, and that's when they come together as a team. So looking a lot better from EG here with their overall draft and play style here in game number two.
Grab the Aegis, Arteezy, scooping that up. So if you thought this Slark was hard to kill already, man, oh man, has he gotten a lot more difficult. Still no Basher on end. He looks like building towards the Vanguard, but still going to be a ways off until he's able to complete it. And that's if he doesn't go for something more defensive, like a Lincoln Spear potentially. But how do they deal with Slark at this point? That's quickly becoming the question of the game. Dire's middle tower is
under attack. Slark. The lockdown of a Basher is just going to be able to kill the Jug that much easier now. This Jug is looking very vulnerable and squishy. 1k HP, and I think the Diffusal Rush is a bit of a trap. The Repel isn't so much the problem, it's just surviving the initiation, the Blink Stun from the Sand King, the Roar, the Slark solo killing you. To do that, you just need HP and stats. Going for the Manta first perhaps would have been the better option.
Just see how much more confident EG are in their position. They're farming the enemy woods. They're holding mid lane with just a support duo, and Sumail quietly continuing to keep his farm up. He's right there with Arteezy. I mean, frankly, it doesn't feel like we've seen much of him since the laning stage, but he's doing his job. And all the while, Universe off in the woods. Necro 3 now complete, 1700 gold bank. EG, like you said, not only choosing good opportunities to fight, but then following that up with some very efficient play to get objectives and maximize their farm moving forward.
Razor has to be like the least splashy carry hero in Dota. That was like fast when you used to play Razor every game and you're just like, well, he's carrying his team, sometimes solo carrying them with how much he farms and doing it in a very unimpressive way. But that's kind of what Sumail is right now. Like, really farmed, maintained great CS, is getting some kills, but just not a flashy hero.
Oh dear. Well, DDC, you're gonna die, my friend. But they do get the last one up and crit. So it will be, it looks like a one for one. Maybe not dead yet. He's committed his ultimate, and yep, see you later. So DDC will drop a one for one support trader on the map. Omni Knight for the Oracle. And now they are gonna try to hunt Arteezy here. He pounces away. Does FY still have that stolen burrow? He does, but they don't have the detection in position. And now Arteezy looking to go back in. He could just burst down FY, prevent him from getting out. Nope, the burrow strike's there. We'll be able to retreat. Now the lift, and there is no follow-up for this.
No bad lesson. Sumail comes in to snipe the Healing Warden. This could, they can't actually get this T2 tower so easily. The creep wave is pushed really deep for now. That was the Antimage pushing it all the way to the tier 3 tower. And N's not done. He's pushing out the mid lane. Needs to be careful because Beastmaster is just behind him.
So it is going to be a Perseverance, and it looks like End will be going for a Lincoln's here.
Sure. It allows him to. This is a game where you can't really team fight. You want to play the split push game, and the Lincoln's provides that more so than like the Vanguard into Abyssal Blade. You're worried about getting caught out. You're not worried about the lack of damage. And that's where the Lincoln's can stop that Blink Roar, can stop a Blink Fire Strike. So I think the item, given the situation and position VG Gaming are in, makes more sense than the Abyssal Blade.
Well, we have seen the Pounce stolen by FY. Not the Dream Rubik's ability. But yeah, it's something, I suppose, as Arteezy continues his relentless pursuit. Will he get the bash? Yes, he will. Three hits, one bash. Oracle here to try and save Ghost, who will Blade Fury out of that pounce, and then Ghost walking back in, commits to the Fusil Blade charge to try and make it up, but the Razor of Sumail arrives, tries to bring him down the Healing Ward. Enough FY pouncing out as Arteezy pounces in, and in the end, Arteezy, he forces a Fusil charge. He walks away and he says, it's time to hit buildings, my friends. I've got an Aegis, a gem still as well. Very confident in this team.
Yeah, they have creeps in the mid lane too. I was like, oh, no backdoor protection, great. And with the creeps in the mid lane, they're just going to go for this Mither X, force the Anti-Mage to fight.
He is walking Lincoln's back though. Down mid like he wants to. But already, Rags will fall on the power of the Beastmaster. Lincoln's is now complete. Can they actually engage? I mean, still, my question is, who do you go on?
Not Arteezy, he's got the Aegis.
You kind of have to jump Universe or Zai, I feel like, else you just have Ward or Burrowed.
Yeah,
you can't ignore Omni. Seems, you don't want to lasso Razor, so... I don't know who you go on, Guts.
Once the Aegis expires, you can get Arteezy playing too aggressive. That's always a consideration, but... Arteezy's been on point without a death to his name yet this game.
Individual play, even as bad as Secret looked as a team and as disappointing as they were for their fans, like his individual play was pretty much immaculate last CI. The one before it, you know, there were quite a few times where he got caught out, but yeah, it's really hard to fault how he played as an individual, and it seems like he is continuing that excellence here on the new EG. They now extend their lead to about 6,000-7,000 gold, 4,000-5,000 experience. A comfortable advantage here, leading 12-4 in a relatively quiet game.
So you're going to find five-man group up in smoke. Arteezy not in there in time to scout this one out.
Maybe can scout them on the way out. He's in the tree line, and he's going to break the smoke. Now looks to jump away, but the Manta's there. He will commit his ultimate. Very defensive play from the Slark. Doesn't try to just run away, courtesy of the Silver Edge. They chase, but they can't find him.
Someone had a gem, right? No gem. Oh, the bat really needed a gem. That's a radiant gem.
That's the one that Crit bought earlier, right?
Yeah. If Batrider has a... He blinked on top of Arteezy when he came out of the Shadow Dance, but just didn't have detection for the Shadow Blade. Goes back to, I mean, you're behind, yes, and money's limited resource, but you've got to have a gem at this stage of the game on the Dire side. Otherwise, EG's just going to win by map control. And Sentries, just, you end up spending so much money on Sentries, you may as well have a gem and go kind of all in.
I mean, they certainly have heroes who could have bought it. DDC went for an Aether Lens. FY went for his Tranquil Soul Rain earned energy booster into Aether Lens. So.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, FY does like to farm on supports, and sometimes it just wins some games, but this could be one where he lives to regret it.
Given how far behind they are right now, he's going to need to make some big plays in these team fights to negate that gold advantage that EG have.
It's just tough for Rubick when he gets caught by Slark. It's not like really a great escape plan unless you've stolen Burrow. And even then, if you get bashed, you're just dead anyway.
Bottles of DD rune. I was about to say he left it there, but he picked it up in a bottle for a team fight. I like this play coming out from EG. He's going to go hunting a bit. Looking for kills. We'll be walking past a lot of sentries here, though, and yeah, he'll recognize himself getting scattered out by the ward.
I mean, they have had sentries, but like you said, it's just at that stage of the game where a sentry is not good enough. You have to have something more reliable.
In a teamfight, those sentries can just get destroyed because Arteezy himself has a gem, so you need that guaranteed detection on your side.
Well, they repel Arteezy and they commence their siege. It's a slow counter push here by End, who is bought out for a basher. There is no Aegis. This is a more aggressive maneuver by EG, but there is a double damage rune currently up on Arteezy. They still jump on him. They're going to try to focus him down. Can they finish him off? He's so low. He's not dead. The Omni Knight ult brings him back up into fighting shape. Zai goes in. He may end up paying for this with his life, but they get Arteezy out safely. They only lose the Sand King for it all.
They fucked up a bit there. They blinked in. The AM blinked in where he thought the lasso tackle was going to be, but he pulled him over the rack. So AM blinked in and landed and couldn't hit the slot. Even just like one or two right clicks would have been enough to kill the Slark, but the coordination between AM and Bat just wasn't there when they initiated, and that cost them. That cost them hard. That was a Slark kill that they miss out on.
That is You know, even though Vici hasn't really changed their roster all that much, the fact that they were switching roles so much in TI, and now they have added one new player, and End wasn't there, maybe you can point to that as part of the issue, but that's just a mistake. You can't afford to be making when a Slark is this farmed and you finally have him where you want him.
Even just having the blink and getting a bash off or something, but yep, as it stands, Vici Gaming still, they're holding on, they haven't lost more than that top melee Rex. Looks like that's easy. Sniper Courier? He's thinking about it? It's really deep now. That's it. If he pops out, he could find himself without a TP and picked off, so. I like the discipline coming out from Arteezy. Every now and then, you get a bit too ahead of yourselves, and when you're the ones in this big lead, the death on the Slark could really swing things back the other way.
I feel like maybe the Arteezy of old would have gone for that, but he's a new man.
And again, the aim was such a good pick this game that Vici Gaming will still be in a decent fighting shape. The itemization from people like Sumail, though, very much geared towards being able to fight the AM, having the AC to amplify the physical damage.
They found DDC. Quick roar. See ya. Now Arteezy looking for more. Juggernaut illusions come out, but he still pursues. The Burrow strike through just to set up into the Yule Scepter. Good catch there and goes to now. Blade Fury tries to run, quickly gets the Bissell controlled and dealt with. Now End even committing onto this one. Does drive Arteezy back for the moment. Still holding on to that Mono Void. This could be big if he gets it off. He will blink out. Now the pursuit onto Yang with the repel. He's very difficult to deal with. They throw Universe back courtesy of that Rubik Lift. The self repel ain't gonna save you against the Bash. And EG finds four. Andy just never had an opening for a killer Mono Void, and without one, it looks like God, we are going to game three.
Great initiation from EG. They get the catch on Oracle, and all it takes is one hero for that position, and Vici Gaming needs every spell and hero they can get when these teams like break out. Not having an Oracle means one of your initiators can't play against it because you have to have the false promise.
Well, there you have it. It's a pretty big Mono Void as EG take their hands off their keyboards. But GG already called. They will force it to distance. Good job salvaging the series. Well, it still felt like Vici had a good waiting stage. It felt like they were very comfortable. It was that mid-game execution where this time around they were lacking.
Yeah, the fight at top where they killed the AM when it was Vici Gaming ganking, and then the Sand King was in the trees, Razor TP's in, Slark shows up at the end. That was like the kind of the biggest fight of the game as far as changing the course of the game. I mean, I think before that it was pretty even. Arteezy was coming online, getting lots of kills, but that was what gave EG a big edge and led to them getting that first Rax up top.
So, looking forward to Game 3, any expected adjustments here? Obviously, there were mistakes in this game, like not getting a gem, but like, how do you look towards Vici approaching that third game?
I don't think they played terribly as a team or anything. The jug, perhaps itemization and just the pick and how it worked this game, you got completely shut down. I think that's probably one of the heroes you look at that just didn't work for you. But outside of that, I don't think they need to necessarily change too much. We'll probably see them go a bit less greedy. The AM was like we think the AM is a really good pick this game, but in the end, it's a very slow pace. And I think Vici Gaming game one, they shine when they had the team fight advantage and could take fights. They don't want to play that slow pace against EG.
All right, guys, best of three series here. Going the distance, EG taking on Vici Gaming. Team that wins this will advance to the winner bracket finals of this GSL group with a great shot to move into the winner bracket of the main event. Should you drop down to the bottom two of your group, you start in the lower bracket, and you've got a long, hard slog if you want to make it towards the grand finals. I'm LD. I'm joined here by Gods. We've only got one stream the rest of the day. We'll be back after this break for that game three. Stick around.